Okay. So I want to welcome everybody to today's service. Good to see y'all once again, amen. We're in a new year, 2017, amen.
What do you do on New Year's Eve?
Well, we just, not a whole lot, you know, just try to stay low and praise the Lord. Be praying and praising the Lord, amen. Okay, well, we're going to go to God in a word of prayer, and we'll get started. Let us pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you this afternoon in Christ's name. We thank you for this day you've given unto us. Thank you for your Spirit being with us, never leaving us nor forsaking us. God Almighty, we come before you confessing our sins, praying that you will forgive us and cleanse us of all iniquity, creating us clean hearts and a new right minds within us. And Father God, we bring before you this afternoon Brother John. He hasn't been feeling well, Lord, as you know. And we pray your hand of blessing and healing upon him, his stomach, and his body, whatever it is that's been causing him to be sick. We pray your hand of health and healing come upon him. We pray, oh God, that you will bless and help each one of us in our struggles. Our bodies are weak, but your Spirit is strong. We come knowing that you are our Heavenly Father, that you care about us. And we thank you and praise you. Bless our time together this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, today we're going to resume in our study of the book of Psalms.
Thank you.
Psalms is a wonderful book. Amen?
Amen.
You should always go to the book of Psalms whenever you're feeling down or whenever you're feeling good. You can always find a word of encouragement in the book of Psalms. And we are in the book of, or the Psalm 24. Psalm 24, and I'll read the Psalm, and then we'll pick up where we left off. The Psalm of David to the Lord. The earth is to the Lord and the fullness of it, the world and those who live in it. For he hath founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall go up into the hill of Jehovah, and who shall stand in his holy place? The clean of hands and the pure of heart, who has not lifted up his soul to guile, has not sworn in deceit. The blessing of Jehovah will rest upon him in righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of his seekers, seeking your face, O God of Jacob, Selah. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, O everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? Jehovah, strong and mighty, Jehovah mighty in battle. Lift up, O gates, your heads, and be lifted up, O everlasting doors. The King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. See you. Amen. Last time we left off talking about the clean of hands and pure of heart, that these are the ones who lift up or bear or carry the blessing from the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
We are God's chosen people. And because of that, God chooses to bless us with good things. Amen. Psalm 84, verse 11 says, the Lord does not withhold any good thing from those who walk uprightly. their cause. And it means to be right. He had a moral, forensic sense. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, in a forensic sense, means in the essence that there is evidence on the table. Amen. Have you ever watched the show Forensic Files? It's a show about detectives and finding evidence of a killer, somebody who killed somebody, right? So forensic science deals with evidence, right? So it says here that righteousness is to be right in a forensic or moral sense. So, it's not enough to just say that you believe in Jesus and then you don't live it. Or you listen to a film on the radio, or you watch it on television, or you speak it with your lips, or you go to places and do things with your hands that you shouldn't do. But to be righteous means to be to cleanse and to clear self. To be or do just or justice, it is to rectitude, virtue, prosperity in a figurative sense. So it doesn't mean to be rich financially, but it means to be rich spiritually. Amen.
Amen.
We don't have a lot of riches here on earth as children of God. But we do have every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Amen. We are very wealthy spiritually. The world is poverty stricken. They are bankrupt spiritually when it comes to their relationship with God. They don't have one. And if you do not have a relationship with the Lord, you are on skid row. Amen?
Amen.
And your skid row that you live on is going in one direction down. You're not getting better, but you're getting worse. Now, the Bible says that one of God's attributes is that He is sovereign, as seen in Psalm 36 in verse 7. Also, that He is just, Job 37:23. He vindicates His people, Micah 7:9. He is truthful, as in Isaiah 38:1. And He is the Son of Righteousness with healing in His wings, as Malachi 3:20 states. God's saving and delivering righteousness, Psalm 22:32, His righteousness endures forever, Psalm 111 verse 3, and man's moral conduct, as seen in Isaiah 64 and verse 5. I'm going to read that last one to you because that's what we're dealing with today, is how it applies to us. It says that the Lord, in verse 1 of Isaiah 64, oh, that thou wouldest rend the heavens, that thou wouldest come down, that the mountains might flow down at thy presence. As when the melting fire burneth, the fire causeth the waters to boil, to make thy name known to thine adversaries, that the nations may tremble at thy presence. For since the beginning of the world, men have not heard, nor perceived by the ear, neither have the eyes seen, O God, beside thee, what He has prepared for him that waited for thee. Thou me behold, thou art wroth, for we have sinned, and those in those is continuance, and we shall be saved. But we are all, verse 6, as an unclean thing. Now here, listen up. And all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags. And we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, have taken us away. And there is none that calleth upon thy name, that stirreth up himself to take hold of thee. For thou hast hid thy face from us, and hast consumed us because of our iniquities. But now, O Lord, thou art our Father. We are the clay, and thou our potter. And we are all work of thy hand. Be not wroth, bear sore, O Lord, neither remember iniquity forever. Behold, see, we beseech thee, we are all thy people. We are all thy people. Amen?
Amen.
Now notice, it does say, first of all, that in verse 5, thou meetest him that rejoices and worketh righteousness. But notice also, in verse 6, the following verse, but we are all as unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as a filthy rag. So what's going on here? Well, this is what's going on. First of all, you've got to realize one thing about your righteousness. It is as a filthy rag in the sight of God. Amen? That's what the Word said, right? And at the same time, you are commanded to do righteousness. So is God interested in our uncleanness? No. But He is interested in what? Our obedience. Right? He's interested in our obedience, even though our obedience is tainted and stained with the awfulness of sin. We can't be sin free, can we, Brother John? We always have sin, don't we? And yet God commands us to live a life that is without sin. Now, how do we do that?
Is that impossible?
Well, in one sense, yes, it is. But that does not negate the command. That does not mean God is bad because He's commanded us to do something that we can't do perfectly. He knows that. He knows we can't do it perfectly. But we are still responsible to do what He tells us to do, right? So if God tells us, for example, driveway of snow. all the snow because the snow is so fine on the ground and on the concrete, it's impossible to get it all out. Amen? Now what am I saying? Well, I'm saying this. That even though the command went out for you to get all of the snow shoveled up, you couldn't do it. You got most of it, and you got it looking good enough for a vehicle to drive on there and not get stuck. God understands that we are not perfect and that our obedience is not perfect. But, on the other hand, He also knows that we have the moral ability as born-again children of God to obey Him as much as possible. Amen?
Right.
We have the ability to say no to temptation and sin. Amen?
Right.
We have the power. How do we have the power? Well, because the Holy Spirit lives in us. Amen, Brother Leroy?
Right.
The Holy Spirit lives in us, and He enables us to say yes to God and no to sin. Now, it doesn't mean we're going to be perfect. That is not what it means. As the Bible here says in Isaiah 64, verse 6, that all of our righteousness is as a filthy rag. Okay? So God says, I want you to live righteously, okay? But your righteousness is not going to be perfect. Your righteousness is going to be sin-stained. It's going to have stains of sin all over, like a rag. What he says for a filthy rag is actually a rag that the women used to use in their time of the month. That's what our good works look like in the sight of God. Now, listen. This is where the Lord comes along. And the Lord takes His righteousness, which has no sin, and He covers our righteousness with His righteousness, and that makes our righteousness acceptable to God the Father. Amen?
Right.
Now you follow me on that? So it's as if there's two presents. There's one, you ever seen a, you know, maybe it happened to you one time, where you were given a present. That happened to me one time, one year. And I opened a present, and then there was another present inside of that present. Another box. I opened that one, and then there was another box. Okay? And I kept on doing it, and there was like five or six boxes, so I finally got to the last box. I can't remember what was in it or not, but I had to go through like five boxes to get to it. This is how our good works, they get covered. The Lord takes our good works, our obedience, our striving, our sharing the Gospels, our resisting temptation and sin, and the Lord covers them with His righteousness and makes them acceptable to the God the Father. Amen? Because without the righteousness of Christ, all of our good works, all of our righteousness, is nothing more than filthy rags. Amen? But with the righteousness of Christ covering our sin-stained righteousness, it makes it acceptable, and we get rewarded because of the righteousness of Christ, which is imputed and being put into our account, and it's also imparted to us via the work of God the Holy Spirit. God the Holy Spirit makes our life practically righteous.
God. Okay? They get the word in Latin, but sanctus, which means holy, and in the Greek it's pangios, and it means to be set apart. So, to be set apart, first, you have to be cleansed. Amen? You're not going to put dirty dishes in the cabinet, are you? No. The dishes have to be washed first, right, Leroy?
Right.
You got to put them in the dishwasher before you put them in the cabinet. So, before God is going to use you, before he's going to hear your prayers, as James 5:16 said, that God hears the prayers of what? The righteous. Amen? God hears, not only does he hear, but the prayers of the righteous are what? Effective. Right? They're effective. They're powerful. So, first of all, you need to be cleansed. You need to be, what that means is you yourself need to cooperate with the Lord, and you need to repent, there's the big million-dollar word, of your sins. To repent. As Jesus says in Matthew 4, chapter 4, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Okay? First you need to repent your sins, and then the process of sanctification will take place. Amen? Then you can begin to be set apart by God. You can begin to be used by God. God will hear your prayers. God will answer your prayers that are according to his word and according to his will. Amen? You don't want to just go around like these crazy preachers on TV, you know, say, praying for, I need $20,000, I need a new house, or I need a new Mercedes, or, you know, stuff like that. That's silly. God will give you what you need, but what you need most of all is to be made whole. To be made like Christ. You don't need a new car, you don't need a new house, you don't need a new wardrobe. God will give you those things. But what you need to be focused on is, am I becoming more like Jesus Christ? Is my heart lining up with the Word of God? God says that we are to be holy, that we are to be blameless. That's a powerful word, isn't it? Blameless? That means nobody in this world should have any bad thing to say about you. And that's pretty powerful, isn't it?
Yeah.
That means you are a righteous person if nobody has anything bad and only good to say about you. Okay. Now, we mess up, don't we? Every now and then, you know, we let the flesh get the best of us, and these words slip out of our mouth. We say things, and we have to confess those, don't we? Now, when you do mess up, you should remember to do one thing, and that is, first of all, confess it to the Lord, and secondly, go to the person that you offended and apologize to them. That way you'll be clean, your hands will be clean, and you will not be carrying around a burden of sin and guilt. So, here is the righteousness from the Lord. And righteousness from the God, his salvation. Okay? So, we isn't an idea. The grace of God isn't a thing. The grace of God is a person, namely the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says that you are to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. God is my grace. Christ is my favor. And Christ is my favor. Christ is my salvation. The Holy Spirit is my sanctification. He is the one who sets me apart. Right? He's the one that not only cleans you up as he causes you to repent of your sins. You know, when you repent of your sins, that's a gift from God. It's not something you do on your own. When you repent, you should be praising God. That God had favor on you, and God granted you the grace in Christ, that's found in Christ, to turn away from your sin. See, we got to get this right, brothers and sisters. You cannot separate the grace of God from Christ. You cannot separate the grace of God from God the Father or from the Holy Spirit. Anytime you hear the word grace, you have got to start thinking about the Lord. Amen. You start thinking about His favor. God blesses you because you are in Christ. He doesn't bless you because you did something great. He blesses you, He blesses me, because we belong to the Lord. Amen? That's why He blesses us. That's good news, amen? And it says here that He will lift up the blessing from the Nova, He will carry the blessing of Nova, righteousness from the God of His salvation. Okay? In verse 5, and the Hebrew actually has it in verse 6, but there was no verses in Hebrew. In the Hebrew literature, they did not remember the verses. Okay? That's something that's done in the English. But anyways, this is the generation of His seekers. Now, there's an interesting word here. Selah. I want to comment on this word Selah, because you often hear the word Selah when you read the word Selah when you're reading in the book of Psalms. And Selah is Salah, is how it's actually pronounced. Salah is the root word, Salah, but this word, Selah, is the Hebrew word, and it means to hang up, or to weigh out, or figuratively, to contempt, tread down underfoot, value, suspension, or music, i.e. a pause, to make light up, throw off, shake off, Selah. Okay? Now what is he saying here? Well, it's used therefore with full knowledge that it indicated some kind of interpretation or change in the regular rendering, and it's used after benedictions and after early Jewish prayers, showing knowledge. It first showed up around in the first century, 100 A.D., it changed from Selah to Amen. Okay? there, then you need to stop and just think about what you read. And just meditate on that. And there's a pause in the music. There was a pause in the writings of the New Testament. Amen. And it is truth. Let it be. It is so. So anytime you hear me say amen, and basically what I'm saying is, you agree? And you say, yes, amen. It is so. You do agree. Selah. Okay. And now, the generation, he says, that this is the generation of his seekers. Not to get too far ahead, but the righteousness that is from God and the righteousness of the God, I like that at the end of verse 5, of the God of his salvation. You know, in the book of Acts, it says, there is no other name given unto heaven, given under heaven, among men, whereby we must be what? Anybody? Saved. No other name but the name of the Lord, Jesus Christ. Given under heaven, among men, whereby we must be saved. Amen? You cannot be saved by Mohammed. He cannot save you. Confucius cannot save you. The church cannot save you. The Pope cannot save you. Mary cannot save you. Okay? No religion in the world can save you. You can only be saved by a person, namely the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to know him, and he has to know you. Okay? That's the only way it works. Amen? Let me give you an example. If there's someone, let's say, there's a fire on the house, a house on fire. If I say fire on the house, my mind must not be working too well. There's a house on fire. Amen. And y'all gotta give me, you can hold me back to name my day. There's a house on fire, not a fire on the house. I don't know what that would look like. What would a fire on the house look like? I know that. But there's a house, let's say there's a house on fire. Okay. And there's a little boy in the house. Okay? Now, the little boy is scared, and he's locked in his room. And he cannot get out, but the house is on fire. So somebody calls the fire department, amen? And you hear the sirens coming, they're coming. The big red truck with all the Christmas lights on it. It's on its way. Okay. And the fire truck gets there and they say, is there anybody in the house? And the people say, yes. There's a little boy. He's in the bedroom on the side of the floor. And he's locked in his room. And the fireman says, okay, we're going to send... We are going to send Captain John up to get the little boy. And Captain John said, I will surely go. He puts his uniform on, his mask, everything. And he climbs up the ladder. He breaks the window and gets into the room. And he sees the room is filled up with smoke. The little boy is sitting in the corner with his little doll. And, or his toughest dog, but his teddy bear, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and saved him from the fire. Amen. So the little boy was not saved from the fire by an airplane. He wasn't saved by a boat or a car, but he was saved by a person, wasn't he? Okay? And the same is true for you and I. Our salvation belongs, it is from the Lord. The Lord Jesus Christ, when he finished his work on the cross, he saved us. You know that he took your old man, your old woman, he took that old person, that filthy old person, he grabbed you by the hand, and he yanked you, and basically threw you against himself, and you were crucified with Christ. Amen? That's what it said, then. Paul said, I was crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. So, not I, but Christ liveth in me. When you are crucified with Christ, as Romans 6 talks about, go ahead and read it sometime, Romans chapter 6, and your sins were nailed to the Lord. And when your sins were nailed to the Lord, guess what? You died with the Lord. The old you died. Amen? And the new you lives. The new you rose with the Lord. When did the Lord get up on what day?
Third day.
Third day, right? That's why the third day in the Bible, anytime you read like third day, it's always signifying completion. Okay? 40 days is a day of testing, but the third day is a symbol of completion and victory. So if the Lord got up the third day, we got up with the Lord. And thank God we did. Because if you don't die with the Lord, guess what? You don't get up with the Lord. You have to be crucified to the Lord, amen? You have got to be nailed to the Lord in order to be raised with the Lord. That means, my friends, that your life has to show evidence of repentance of sin. Amen. If you don't have any repentance going on in your life, then guess what? You didn't die with the Lord on the cross. You're still alive to sin and death, not with the Lord on the cross, but you're still dead to the Lord. Amen? Follow me? The next time you are tempted to do evil, you need to stop and say to yourself, Sila. I need to think about this before I do it, amen? I need to stop and meditate on what I'm about to do because I know that if I do this, if I say this, if I do whatever I'm thinking about doing, and I know it ain't right, you know what's going to happen? You're going to incur the disfavor of the Lord. God will not be pleased with you, and you will have to deal with his chastening hand. Now, it's my job as a preacher to admonish you to stay in the Word of God. Amen? I cannot save you. I cannot even sanctify you. All I can do is preach to you and to conduct my life according to the Word of God. Now, if you hear about, if you hear something like, oh, well, I heard Pastor Ferguson, he's a big-time gambler. But he preached the other day against gambling. He said it was bad and evil. Well, I heard he was down at the casino every day. Well, that ain't no fraud, is it? Well, because that makes me what? A hypocrite, right? A hypocrite. I cannot do things that I say are wrong. If I do, then I'm a hypocrite. So, pastors such as myself, we have a great burden. We have to really scrutinize ourselves. Everything I say to you, I have to do myself. See, I'm not exempt. Alright? Now, the same is true for you because you're hearing it. Just because I'm saying it, you know, you're hearing it too. So you're responsible to do it too. Alright? Well, unless I'm saying something that's not true, you know, if I'm lying to you, if I'm saying something that's not according to the Word of God, then, you know, you shouldn't do it, right? You should only hear what's according to the Word of God. And what I'm telling you to do is to be like the Lord, to be holy, to think good thoughts, holy thoughts, pleasant thoughts, thoughts about the Lord. When your mind is on the Lord, you don't have time to be thinking about sin. Amen. You need to think about the Lord and His goodness and what you can do for the Lord. Or you're thinking about the flesh. You know, what I can do for me. What can I give? You know, it's more blessed, as Acts 20 verse 30 says, more blessed to give than to receive. Amen? God says, give me all of your heart. Give me all of your mind. Give me all of your body. And you know what I'll give you? Every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. I'll give you everything you need in this life. There's a story about a young boy. And he got his hand caught in the cookie jar. Okay? You ever heard this one? Well, yeah, what happened was there was a special jar that had a few cookies in it, and he reached in there, and evidently, I guess, he seen a cookie that he really liked, and once he got his hand on it, he got the cookie in his hand, and he made a fist, right? Well, and then the word got around, says back to the dad, Joey got his hand stuck in the cookie jar, and he can't get it out. And dad found out about this. So he finds little Joey. Sure enough, his hand was stuck wedged down in there. And dad said, let's just pull a little harder. Let's pull. He said, okay, Joey, hold on. And brother's going to hold the jar, and I'm going to yank on you, and we're going to get your hand out of there. Well, he started tugging, and it wouldn't come out. And he says, now what's going on, Joey? Where's your hand? How'd you get your hand in there? And what are you doing? Now, why can't you get your hand? He says, well, I'm not willing to let go of this cookie. And that's why my hand's not coming out. So he had a fist, he was making a fist, and the dad said, now, Joey, you've got to let go of the cookie in order to get your hand out. Okay? And so as soon as Joey let go of the cookie, then guess what? His hand came right out. So you and I need to keep our hands out of the cookie jar, first of all. And number two, if God wants to give you a cookie, He'll do it in His own time. Amen. Don't go into jars that say, keep your hands out of that. Amen. Remember, I preached a sermon one time on chocolate cake. Yeah. That's your forbidden fruit. Now, whatever your forbidden fruit is, whatever your weak point is, that's what you need to stay out of. Amen. So God has good have to wait on the Lord. The Lord will give us good things in His time, not our own. Okay? Now, Saul is an example of somebody who is impatient, isn't he? Samuel said to Saul, now you wait here, Saul, and I'll be back, and I'll make the offering for the people. Because Samuel was a priest. Saul was not. Well, Saul got impatient, and he said, I don't know where this Samuel, he ain't coming back. And the opposing army is right over here. We're about to get attacked. I need to make a sacrifice to the Lord. And he went ahead and did it without Samuel. Well, Samuel came back and said, what have you done? You were supposed to wait for me. Saul said, I didn't know what happened to you. I went ahead and made the burnt offering. Samuel says, you're in big trouble. And now you've lost the kingdom. Because you took it upon yourself to do something that God had not called you to do. Amen. It's the same in our walk with the Lord. When we get impatient and say, no, I must have it. I must have it now. And God says, well, you know what? If you insist, but I'm going to let you have it, there's a high price to pay for it. Amen. There's a high price to pay for heaven. You're going to lose the blessings of the Lord. You're going to get your little cookie, but God has a nice big wedding cake for you. With lots of ice cream and cookies and fun, and you thought you had something with that little chocolate chip cookie. Okay? God has something bigger and better for you. But you have to wait, as Isaiah says, and 40 and 31, they that wait upon the Lord, they shall what? Renew their strength. Amen? They'll renew their strength, and they will run and not faint, and they will walk and not be weary. Amen? You'll mount up with wings as eagles. Now, you know when an eagle, anybody in here ever seen an eagle, you know, flying in the sky? Well, it's a lot different than a little sparrow, isn't it? Yeah, the eagle, he just stretches his wings out and lets the wind carry him, doesn't he? The sparrow, he just flaps really hard and makes his own wind. Isaiah did not say, you shall mount up with wings as a sparrow. Amen. He did not say you shall mount up with wings as a bluebird, or a robin, or a bird, or a redbird, a carter. He said you'll mount up with wings as what? Eagle. Eagle just holds them out. Now what position am I in now? I look like I'm on a cross, right? Well, when you hold your arms out, then you're being crucified. You're in a position of crucifixion, like this. So that's what God wants us to do. He wants us to be in the state of crucifixion daily. Paul says, I die daily. Amen? You get on that cross every day. That's the cross of self-denial, right? And Jesus said, no man can come after me unless what? Unless he deny himself. Amen? And take up his cross, and then you can follow me. First you have to deny yourself, and then once you're denying yourself, then you're ready to go to the cross. Amen? Jesus had to deny himself when? In the Garden of Gethsemane. Right? That's when he struggled. That's where he fought off the temptation. Because his body, the human side of Jesus, didn't want to go to that cross, did it? He said, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. The cup was the cup of wrath that God the Father was going to pour out on God the Son. And God the Son, Jesus, is not going to drink that cup. Would you want to drink it? No. Would I? Absolutely not. Because you know what was in that cup? All of the wrath of God that would have been poured out against favor of God is when we are living and walking in the Lord. Amen? Now it says here, and I'm just about through, but it says that this is the generation that is seekers, seeking your face. The generation is the Hebrew word door, D-O-W-R, and pronounced dore, and it means a revolution, a time, i.e. age or generation, a dwelling. Now, listen. The Bible says that we are a peculiar people. Amen? A royal priesthood. A generation of seekers seeking your face. You know, that's where it's at, is in seeking the face of God. You know, God Almighty, the Lord Jesus Christ, is here in this room right now. You realize that? You're standing in His presence. You say, I don't see Him. Well, you don't see the air you breathe either. But you know it's there. Because if we didn't have any air, Brother Ernest, we'd drop down dead, wouldn't we? Yeah. Now, just because you can't see it, that breathing ain't there. The Lord Jesus Christ, God the Father, and God the Holy Spirit is in this room right now. Now, that ought to make us fear and tremble a little bit, amen? Not a little bit, a lot. Because, as God said to Moses, you better take your dirty shoes off your feet. The place which you're standing is what? Holy ground. Why is it holy ground? Because God is right there in the midst. You say, was that the only place where there's holy ground? No. Actually, everywhere is holy ground. Because God is everywhere. Amen? Alright, let's get this straight. Because just because what God said to Moses, get your shoes off, this is holy ground. He didn't say that's unholy ground over there. Alright? Everywhere is holy ground. He just wanted Moses to understand that you need to realize when you're in the presence of God, then you are standing on holy ground. Amen.
Holy ground.
That means the Lord is in our presence, the Lord is in our midst.
Yeah.
I don't care, it doesn't matter what you're going through, guess who's going through it with you? The Lord God Almighty. Matter of fact, the Lord is the one who wrote the script for you to go through. The Lord is the one who ordered. He actually said, now I want this to come upon my child. I want this illness. I want this disease. I want this sickness. Why? Because I'm going to prove my power in their weakness. Amen? That's what it says in the Bible. Paul says, would you please remove this thorn from me? He didn't say it once. How many times? Three. Please remove this thorn. It's killing me, Lord. God says, ain't going to do it. Why? Because my power is perfected in your weakness. My grace is more powerful than your illness. Amen? My love. Who I am. Don't you know I'm the one that's sitting upon you? What are you thinking? That I've forsaken you. Did God forsake Job when he afflicted him, when he told the devil, I'm going to get it? No. Because God was the one who wrote the script. Amen? God was the one, you ever watch a movie, and at the end it says, or beginning, or it says director, so-and-so. Well, your life, and it says, your life is the movie. It says director, God. Okay? How do you like that? Director, God. He's the director, amen? God is the director. You say, well, I'm not too happy about my life. Well, I'm sorry, I'm not too happy about mine either, but we can be happy if we realize this one thing. God is the director, amen? We've all made bad decisions, right? We could have made better decisions. just want to thank you for my illness and my weakness, because your word says all things work together for my good, including this. This must be for my good, so I'm going to thank you for it, as Job did. Did Job give the Lord thanks? Yes, he did. God took everything he had, just about, took all his children, took all his land and everything. Job fell down and he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I shall return. The Lord gave, and guess what? The Lord has taken away. And you know what? Verse 21, blessed be the name of the Lord. He started praising the Lord. Amen? The man lost everything. He just said, I'm going to praise God. I'm going to fall down on my face and thank you, Lord. Amen? And you know what his wife's reaction was? She looked at old Job and said, you got me out of your mind. You need to cuss God out and kill yourself. You just lost everything. You lost your health. You've lost everything. You lost your children and you're praising the Lord. What's wrong with you? You lost your mind. Job looked at her and said, you speak as one of the foolish men to speak. Shall we only receive good from the hand of the Lord and not evil and not bad? Okay. Shall we only receive help but not illness? Well, doesn't work that way, does it? We are the clay, as Isaiah 64 just said, and God is the potter. Amen? God is the potter. That means he's the director of your life. Now, listen. The people in a clay, they have to do whatever the director tells them to do, right? And those who are successful actors, well, they do it real good, don't they? They remember the script, whatever they're told to do, and they do it. They're good actors, right? Well, God is not calling us to be actors, but he's calling us to be doers of his word. The script is the word. God wrote the script. The script, sure, is his word. Amen? God said, now, if the playwright, if it's the script, alright, and I want you to do it, you got to do the script. And this is not a play, this is reality, amen? This is real life, alright? And so, you know, actors, they get to live a double life. They get to be somebody in front of the camera, then there's somebody else off screen. Now, you and I, we got to be what God commands us to be in his word. So it's imperative that you spend time in the word of God, that you live a righteous life. Amen? But at the same time, don't get caught up and get the big head syndrome and say, I'm righteous and you're wicked, you're unclean and you're dirty, I'm holy and you're unholy. No. You need to be righteous. You need to live righteously. But you need to remember that all of your righteousness apart from Jesus Christ is nothing more than a filthy rag. Amen. Nothing more than a filthy rag. That's how you give God the glory. See, what do I do? The only thing you can do is give God the glory. Amen. Naked I came, naked I shall return. The Lord gave, the Lord is taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Okay? God might give you riches, he might give you poverty. Doesn't matter. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen? Today you may be standing, tomorrow you may be in a wheelchair. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen? Yeah. Now one thing we can do to guard ourselves from unnecessary chastisement is to just be obedient to the word of God. Amen? Or be obedient. As long as you're obedient, like it says in the book of Acts, you know, they told him to quit preaching the name of Jesus. And when you guys just be quiet about what Jesus got, you're making a big commotion in this city. They said, we don't care whether it's right on your side or whose side, we're going to keep preaching in the Word of God and always be obedient to the Word. Amen? That's what it's all about. Your righteousness is in Christ. You are righteous in Christ. Now you have to live it out. You understand? You're righteous in Christ. Now live it out. Now be righteous. Amen? Prove yourself a woman of God. Prove yourself a man of God. Don't just tell me you're a Christian. Prove it. Amen? I'm from Missouri, where I grew up. That's the show me state. Well, you know, I got this lawnmower, man, it works great. We look down and say, show me. Alright? Show me. Let's see it work. Alright? That's what the world wants today. They want to see some real, genuine Christianity. Amen? And the church is weak today because it's filled with impotent Christians. Christians that are not showing the world what it means to be a man or woman of God. Amen? We compromise.
It's a lot different than what it
used to be. Yes, it is. It's a lot different than what it used to be.
Yeah.
So we're going to stop there for today. I'm going to close with the word of prayer, and then we'll be finished. Let us go to God in a final word of prayer. Will you pray with me? Our gracious Heavenly Lord, we thank you once again for your word. It's a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our path. You've given us everlasting life. You have given us your righteousness. You have covered our filthy righteousness with your pure righteousness. We thank you, O God, for giving us the word of life. We thank you for causing us to repent of our sins, for making us new each and every day, for making us over, for cleansing us and setting us apart. Forgive us, Father, of our sins. Forgive us for being arrogant and rude. Forgive us of the words that we have spoken, for even taking your name in vain. Forgive us, O God, for not living in your presence as we ought to be living, for not taking our filthy shoes off while we are standing in your presence. The shoes of sin, the shoes of corruption, the shoes of self-deceit, the shoes that should not even be on our feet. God, we pray that you will help us to keep ourselves from all sin. You will cause us to walk in your word. You will enable us to be obedient unto your word. That we will be a people that puts a smile on your face, Father, and not a frown. That we will prove ourselves men and women of God. That we will not be hypocritical in our sayings and our doings. We will show the world that you are